Land Rover's three-row Discovery SUV sits between the uber-luxurious Range Rover and the rugged Defender in the SUV lineup. And it offers a little bit of both worlds with a premium interior and loads of off-road capabilities. For 2021, the Discovery got a light update that keeps it looking fresh and stylish. And inside, its new multimedia system keeps it modern and competitive. However, some ergonomic and storage issues create problems for this otherwise mostly comfortable, capable SUV. Let's check it out. The cabin's streamlined, no-nonsense design and premium materials combine for a lovely look and feel. A few new features join the cabin this year, and I'm mixed on a couple of them. First, the 11.4-inch touchscreen sits high on the dash, and it's a great spot for easy readability and usability. It has large icons, crisp graphics, and an easy menu structure. My problem is response time. The system seems pretty slow to engage and slow to switch tasks, and connecting Android Auto takes many seconds more than in competitors. A couple other problems are that the volume knob sits ahead of the shifter, which is kind of an ergonomically awkward reach, and there is no tuning knob. The climate controls below the main screen are also needlessly complicated. You either push, pull, or spin the dials depending on what function you need. For example, push the dial to turn up the heated seat temp, pull the dial to adjust the fan speed, or spin the dial to increase the car's temp. And using the buttons next to the climate dials takes more force than in any other vehicle I've ever been in. You really need to push them in order to get them to do anything. You can also do many of the climate functions through the touchscreen, but navigating to that menu takes a couple steps. Other new highlights for the cabin include a 12.3-inch digital gauge cluster and a full-color head-up display for the driver. Land Rover said it added more padding to the second-row seats for 2021, and they're properly comfy, and head and leg room are great for two adults back here. A bench seat is the only seating configuration available, however, and some competitors offer second-row captain's chairs. The second row also does well when it comes to kids, thanks to accessible latch anchors and accessible top tether anchors. Using Cars.com's car seats, we were able to install two car seats in the second row comfortably. Three almost fit. If you use narrower car seats, you may be able to get three on the second row bench. Kids will also appreciate the 9 available USB ports peppered throughout the cabin, as well as the click and go tablet holders incorporated into the front seat backs. Things look less rosy when you head to the third row. Moving the seats to get to the third row is a slow, heavy process. The opening is small, and the step-in height is pretty tall for smaller kids to manage on their own. The second row splits in a 40-20-40 split, but once the seat is folded, it's awkward to climb over to get to the third row. In the third row, headroom is great, but legroom is really tight, even for kids. Also, the seat back here is pretty thin and uncomfortable, and the windows are small and narrow, so it's got kind of a cave-like vibe. I wouldn't regularly use this third row, even for my kids, because it's such a pain to get back here, and it's pretty uncomfortable. In terms of amenities, however, there's a lot back here. Each occupant gets a cup holder, a small storage box, and a USB port. There's also two sets of latch anchors for car seats, but getting the car seats back here is a huge pain, and legroom is again a big issue. The other problem with the third row is how much it eats into cargo space. With both seats in use, there's only room for a couple of grocery bags back here. It's only about 10.5 inches deep, which is a deal breaker for me. If I can't fit my family of 5 in the Discovery and all of their stuff, it's not gonna work. One nice thing to note is that it has a standard air suspension, which raises and lowers the back, which could also help with bigger cargo. There are some big changes with the powertrain this year with two new turbocharged engines. There's a 296 horsepower 4-cylinder and a 355 horsepower 6-cylinder. The diesel has been canceled. I tested the 6-cylinder, which roars to life on startup with a throaty, mean exhaust note. But it doesn't provide quite as much gusto as it sounds. After a brief lag, acceleration is strong from a stop and adequate on the highway. The 8-speed automatic transmission quickly and smoothly delivers more power, but becomes less adept and more awkward on deceleration, where shifts lag and feel clunkier. On the road, the Discovery has a solid, stout presence, but occasionally handling feels clumsy, like in corners where there's a lot of body lean. It's not agile by any means, and you'll never forget that you're driving a tall, heavy vehicle, but it's overall comfortable with good composure over bumps, likely thanks in part to that standard air suspension. Where it shines, I'd imagine, is off-road. I only tested the Discovery on pavement, but its long list of off-road goodies is impressive. Aside from standard all-wheel drive, there's also the Terrain Response 2 system with several adventure-ready modes, such as grass, gravel, snow, mud ruts, sand, rock crawl, and a new wade mode for crossing rivers. There's also an optional 2-speed transfer case and a locking rear differential. This 6-cylinder model is loaded and costs around $73,000. With solid road manners, an inviting cabin, and loads of capabilities for the road less traveled, the Discovery does a lot of things well. But for those looking for a better balance between people space, cargo room, and a less fussy multimedia setup, the Discovery comes up short.